But it's an honor for me to deliver the talk when Dr. Atmanand is the chairman and Dr. Sunil Singh is with him. I'm slightly digress from my talk. The title of the talk is given to me is Underwater Technology for Polar Research. Though the title is like that, I'll be talking more about the underwater vehicles for polar research. This is the typical sales talk. What is the requirement of, or what is the necessity of making that kind of vehicles for polar research? These are the actually benefits. One is that from starting from the near ice inspection and mapping, we can even do the lake exploration. There are a lot of lakes in Antarctica, freshwater lakes, inland lakes, we can do the exploration. And we can even do biological sampling and instrument and placement. So we say that if seeing is believing, sampling is proving. So ROV can see and it can sample as well. So what is the prior art? Before the this underwater vehicles were actually employed for these purposes, they were using this kind of upward looking sonars for ice measurements and all. And because these are actually point measurements at one location, and large number of instruments were required for getting any beneficial data, and data latency, and there was no actually online data acquisition, so we had to wait till the actually the instrument is recovered. And of course, using divers is actually it's quite common, but it's only for a short duration, because the endurance of the diver in that conditions is very difficult. Actually, it's very short actually. And also it's very hazardous. I read a story about how one diver was actually advised not to dive again in his lifetime because of some accident there. So it's really hazardous there. So for that, this thing actually, they have started making this submersible for this polar research. And though there are many are there actually, but I listed a few of them which are more successful. One is actually employed by MBORI, that is actually Monterey Bay Research Institute, and the Moss Learning Marine Laboratories in California. They made an ROV, or it's a sort of a combination of AUV, that is autonomous underwater vehicle and remotely operated vehicle. They deployed it in Antarctica by just digging a hole like this in ice and all. And you can see the pictures they have got there, and they have got quite a number of pictures and samples also. And the University of Genoa also, they deployed one ROV there. And you can see how they have actually made a hole in the ice, and then they core this place, and then they launch the ROV there into the. So you can see this is the paper from Wood's hole. Actually, they use this ROV, their ROV, for measurement of, for mapping the thick and deformed ice in Antarctica. Actually, this helps in actually validating the models, that sea ice models, and then actually validation of the satellite data, and they have used it for that purpose. Before that one, recently actually, not very recently, a Lake Vostok was actually discovered at around 4 kilometers below the ice actually. By Russians, it is actually below the Russian station called Vostok in Antarctica. And the pristine ecosystem has been actually preserved or covered by some 4 kilometers thick ice, sheltering it from the sunlight and protecting it from the environment. So we can say that there, some kind of ecosystem is there where the organisms actually, they don't depend on the sunlight and oxygen, but they live on the actually chemicals which are available in the rocks. So these extremophiles could mimic the life on the moons and planets such as Jupiter's icy moon Europa. But what they did is that they didn't drill through the this thing and reach the water. They stopped maybe 100 meters above the water level actually, because they don't want to contaminate the water. They are still contemplating to send some vehicles into this one. This was done by a team, a joint team of US, Russia and French. So with these things in mind, actually we started making the remotely operated vehicle for this Antarctic waters. And these are the specifications. Though we are interested only demonstrating the vehicle, we made a payload actually based on our estimation of what is required by the scientists from these waters. And they range from light cameras to bottom corer, scanning sonar, irradiance meter, and normal CTD sensors and all. And we try to make an ice core. Our idea is to go below the ice and take a sample from the actually the ice shelf actually. That we try to do it actually. So this is the conceptual view of the ROV we started doing. And these are the tentative specifications. Then we did some stability analysis, hydrostatic stability and hydrodynamic stability we have done. And then starting from the scratch, we built the ROV. And finally, when it was made, it looked like this. It's a sonar, actually upward looking sonar. And it weighed around 170 kg. So what we did is we tried this in our tank at NIOT. And later we took it to a freshwater lake in Kerala in the west coast of India. And we tried the ROV, especially for the navigation, because under navigation, actually under ice, we don't have any signals and all. We don't know where it works. We can't even use the acoustic positioning system. So we use the inertial navigation system with the Kalman filter. So we tried it there in the lake there. And after that, we found that, okay, the water temperature can be as low as minus 2 degrees in Antarctica. So what we tried is that we kept this total, the integrated ROV into one environmental chamber. And we took the temperature down up to minus 5 degrees. And we saw what are the changes that can occur. Apart from the normal, actually, contraction and springs and bolts and nuts actually becoming loose, we have some other things. We have seen that differential contraction was there. It was corrected, and some electrical parameters of the cable also, umbilical cable and all, they do change. So we have to make some adjustment in the power system. That also we have done. And this was the action plan actually. We have a lake in front of our station Maitri there. So we wanted to explore that Priyadarshini lake, which is almost 6 meters deep. And also we wanted to go to the edge of the continent and launch the ROV below the ice and take a core from there. With that one, we set the equipment there, and when we reached there, the equipment was lying there for 2 months actually, half buried in ice. We took it out and then we just made the garage or workshop, and we started assembling the ROV there. And small electronic components which were strewn around were taken away by SCOAs and all. So we had to safeguard our equipment from these birds also there, which are, they're called actually flying monkeys there. So finally, we launched the ROV into the water. You can see a man actually who helped us in launching it there. But he was very happy because the outside temperature was minus 6 degrees and inside it was only 1 degree centigrade. He was warm actually. So we made a tent there. We pitched a tent. We can see MCOR and NIOT team there. This we made it as our control room. Actually, we kept our workstation there and all. And we started operating the ROV there. And we found that there are a lot of rocks covered with algal mats in that existing that lake. We took a lot of samples and we took a lot of photographs and video images. And within 3 days, actually, what happened was there was a blizzard and we were confined to the our actually containers. And when we came out, we saw that the lake actually froze, so we could not do much there. So what we did is we shifted the radiator to the we have gone to the actually the edge of the continent there actually that so it's the shelf we have gone there. We surveyed that area and then we moved the equipment helicopter there, and we just kept it there on the ship. I think the ship name was Papanin, a Russian ship, and we occupied their that entertainment room, and we made it our laboratory there, and we started launching the ROV here. You can see there we wanted to go below this actually ice shelf. So what we did is we went down up to 60 meters. Nobody knew what was the thickness of that one. At 60 meters, we had some trouble with the equipment. Actually, one of the connectors failed, so we repaired it for two days, and again we launched it again 60 meters. We had another failure, but you can see this is the continent. This is the ice shelf actually. We found that this ice thickness is more than 60 meters, and that was a good data for the people who want to really dock our ships there and all. We collected a lot of scientific data. You can see these are irradiance. That means at almost 60 meters, that penetration of sunlight is almost zero. And when we are coming up again, you can see how it was building up. And we recorded the temperature also, and we recorded the salinity also. What we found is that we did the deployment at two locations. But the salinity was slightly different. The locations were not very far away, but the salinity was really quite different. So still we could not explain that that anomaly there. So these are the problems encountered. When we went there, we were told that never bring one. That means you always carry multiple number of equipment and components and all. But they never told us that don't come for a month, because in a month we got hardly 4-5 days of working time there. So probably we should have planned for a longer time. But anyway, we actually improved the system. That means we have increased the operational time. Umbilical cable became very stiff. Actually, the cables became so stiff there actually. Even the ordinary USB cables now, they were like rods. And the static was so much actually, the equipments were failing very often. Even when we shake hand with each other, actually, then we used to give some talk to each other that this thing was static. Okay, so what we did is we improved all those things. But the work is still in progress. All this happened in 2015, but after that we have not gone to Antarctica or Arctic. The reason is that it is very gratifying to demonstrate the equipment and feel happy about it. But if there is no science plan associated with that one, then actually there is not of much use. So we are waiting for the science plan. Probably with the NCO or scientists will be able to devise a good science plan before we go to Antarctica or Arctic with our vehicles. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ramdas. So some question? No, no question. It's okay. Thank you again. Thank you very much. So we'll move to next talk. Next talk will be given by Dr. Manish Tripathi. Again from Manish Tiwari from NCR. And he'll be talking about possible error in marine and terrestrial carbon sequestration budget for the Arctic region.